We had the rehearsal, and I only got one good laugh out of this joke because I had it all planned when we were getting ready to do the wedding thing, and I stood up there with my black book and getting ready to say, and I started, "He was a good man," and I said, "Oh, wrong book." And only one person caught it. I thought, man, I thought that was a quality joke. But obviously it wasn't as quality as I thought. Hallelujah. Huh?
I explained it to George, then he
laughed. Yeah, yeah. I thought it was cute, ain't he? Amen. Yeah. You guys are blessed. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. No summer slump. Say that with me. At True Life Church. In Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, we know people got vacations, and vacations are good. Amen. It's good to relax and get away. And hopefully sometimes vacations can be more stressful than they can be. They don't have to be. But, to me, vacation is about just taking it easy and being together. And I've told people before that sometimes Jen and I, we can get in the car and just cruise over to Richmond and talk and, the kids with us or whatever, and just fellowship and go to Starbucks. And, that's like a vacation, and it's good. Amen. Sometimes we get so busy that we make everything so frantic. And Cecil tells a story about on that island. Remember that? And it was a real small island, and they had a couple people that were turning 100 years old, and they were celebrating their 100th birthday. Remember him telling that story? And the island's real laid back. It's real small. You can only go about 35 miles per hour. It's just tropical. It's beautiful. And he said, man, he goes, that's normal. Celebrating people living 100 years and more is a normal thing. And then he said he found out why. He said, they don't pay taxes. No, so amen. All right. Praise the Lord. I'm going to start this so I do not forget to start it. I've already announced the 4th of July service. All right, are you ready? If everything's on, we're ready to roll. I've entitled this message, The Many Faces of Self-Righteousness. The Many Faces of Self-Righteousness, because sometimes we don't understand the magnitude of self-righteousness and how deep it runs in us. Amen? Self-righteousness is self-trust. In fact, if I could have Romans chapter 6, verse 14, just take a quick look at this, and this will help you. Amen? I actually had to alleviate some of these notes because I had so many of them. Hallelujah. Most of you have heard this verse, are familiar with this verse. It's powerful. But I just want to give you a real simple definition that I believe will help you to understand this and the theme throughout the entire New Covenant, throughout the entirety of the Word of God. But it says, "For sin shall not have dominion over you, or it shall not lord itself over you." Why? Somebody say, why?
Why?
For you are not under law, but under grace. And here's something that will help you. How can you tell if you're under law, and how can you tell if you're under grace? Under grace, it's about Jesus. Under law, it's about you. Isn't that simple? Doesn't that help you? Under grace, it's about Jesus. Under law, it's about you. Now, it kind of helps me to understand that many times I'm operating under law, even though I don't think I am. I love what Naomi said, something so good. She said, legalism, I love this definition, is nothing more than man's attempts to control the darkness. Naomi Cantrell right there. Legalism is nothing more than man's attempts to control the darkness. Isn't that amazing? That's a great definition. And but anyhow, this will help you. And that's why I thought to myself, I think, well, people think, well, I'm not self-righteous. Not me. I mean, I bless God, I'm under grace. In fact, Barry Bennett did a powerful Facebook quote where he talked about spiritual hippies. Anybody remember the hippies or heard of the hippies? Back in the 60s and early 70s, there was the hippies, and they just balked at any type of structure, any type of authority, any type of discipline. And he said, there's a lot of people that think they're under grace and they're nothing more than spiritual hippies. No discipline, no nothing, and they think that's grace. That's not grace. That's law. That's law. Law is when you make yourself God. See, many times we play God. Whenever I make my truth over the truth of the Word of God, I'm playing God. Is anybody hearing that? Whenever I make my interpretation of truth, the truth, over God's Word, the truth, I'm playing God. That's law. That's establishing my own standard. There's only one standard. His name is Jesus.
Amen?
Amen. So see, there's a lot of spiritual hippies in that think they're under grace. In fact, I believe if you're under grace, you ought to be more disciplined than you ever was when you was legalistic. But see, some people, when they first get free, they're like the dog in the house. You've heard me tell that story. You have this dog in the house, and he loves his master, and he's just great, and a great dog. But you don't want to open the door, because if he gets out, the whole neighborhood's going to be trying to catch him, right? Some people are praying he gets hit. Some people, no, I'm just kidding. You know, I'm kidding. And then it's like, golly, man. But you know what I'm talking about. It's not that he doesn't like his owner. It's just that he's been confined to this house for so long and what he deems as freedom. But you know, you leave a dog that's been a country dog that's been has the freedom to run for miles. But you know, been there doesn't mean anything. Just lays on the porch and just, you know what I'm saying. But see, if we really understand what grace is, and I've given this definition, I want to give it again because it's the best by far that I've ever heard. Yes, grace is unmerited favor. But it's actually God's ability that's given to us on an undeserved, unmerited basis. That's why it says sin won't have any dominion over you if you're unless you're under law. But if you're under grace, once again, grace makes it about Jesus. Law makes it about us. So how many times am I about me? I love what Cecil said. Whenever you put yourself into the equation, into the problem, into the situation, you become part of the problem. Amen? How many times do we do that? Amen. All right. Are you ready? That was all introduction. Okay. All right. Let's go to, I want to review Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Got my little thing here. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Watch this. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty by which Christ has made us free, and do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. I'm not going to go over all this because we've talked about it, but I want to say the instructions to you and I as a believer are to stand fast. Stand fast. That means that we can be rocked off our position and our understanding in relationship with God. Many believers are. You know, many believers, even though they're not under the curse of the law, they still operate under a curse, even though they're not under a curse. Because they don't understand. See, the fight is with our thinking. That's the fight. And yes, the devil is a factor, but in so much as he throws stuff at us. And sometimes situations that look contrary to the goodness of God, and you see that, man, I thought God was good, but why am I going through this? Listen, you're in a broken world. Amen? None of us are exempt from the situations in this world. Amen? And Jesus said, in the world you have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. The Bible says, all who will live godly, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. No, I'm not confessing that. I'm just telling you the truth. We need to recognize that. But that doesn't mean we have to let those things get on the inside of us. See, people try to live the Christian life from the outside in rather than the inside out. And herein lies the problem. Amen? You know, I was thinking today, you know, there was a time when the crowd would be down and that would bug me. And sometimes it tries to get on me, but I'm so excited about the word anymore. And it's just getting stronger and stronger and stronger the more I relate to him. And I'm not saying I'm there. I haven't arrived, but I have left. Amen? In my understanding, I'm growing in this. But I'm telling you, we can get to the place where it doesn't matter what goes on the outside. Amen? This is why I want to preach on heaven sometime. Because when you get a big picture perspective, all of a sudden, these little trivial things don't mean so much. Why do you think the Apostle Paul could say, I don't count my life dear unto myself, so I could finish my course with joy? The reason we struggle is because we're counting ourselves. We think this is it. This isn't it. Paul even said, I have a desire to depart and be with Christ, which is not a little bit better, far better. Amen? So you get that kind of perspective. That's why everything they did to Paul, and boy, he went through all kinds of persecution. He said it's a light affliction. You ever read about Paul's light affliction? Stone, shipwreck, a night and a day in the deep, left for dead, beat with rods. I mean, light affliction? My word, when somebody looks at me cross-eyed, that's persecution. I'm kidding. Amen? But see, when you get that kind of perspective, it just puts everything in perspective. 50, 60 years at the most, I mean, come on. And that's why, and then when you get that way and you get past this fear of death, then all of a sudden the power of God's able to kick in. That's a whole subject. But anyhow, stand fast therefore in the liberty. The word liberty means freedom. Now we have to ask ourselves this question, freedom from what? Freedom from what? See, this is where here's where people's definitions get whacked. They say, well, I'm blessed God, I'm free. That dog that got out of the house is free to run across the road. Not a good idea, especially when cars are coming. Amen? That's not freedom. Freedom has to do with freedom from having to measure up through the requirements of the Mosaic law. Oh, but this is predominantly Gentiles and they didn't receive the law. Yes, the law was given to one nation, Israel, but it condemned the whole world. And when you understand you're free, you understand that you've already measured up in Christ. Are you hearing me? That's the freedom he's talking about. That's why it says in 2 Corinthians 3:17, now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty or freedom. And then it says, but we all, with open or unveiled face, beholding as in a glass or a mirror. See, we have a part here. Our part is the beholding. Amen? That's our part. We're changed. We're metamorphosed from glory to glory. In other words, we start living life from the inside out instead of the outside in. Hear the difference? See, if we're living our lives from the outside in, then every little thing that people say to us causes us to go and fall apart like a $2 suitcase, as Andrew says. Right? Because we're living from the outside in. And then all of a sudden, everything people say to us, that's what matters. You know it don't matter what people say about you? It matters what God said about you. And he says you're blessed and highly favored. If you live your life trying to please people, I'm telling you, it's a roller coaster. And as soon as you get one of them happy, then you got somebody else that might be mad with you. Amen. But if we look to Jesus and we trust him and we live from the inside out instead of the outside in. Amen. And it comes through recognizing this taproot of self-righteousness. I'm going to get into some things today. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty or the freedom by which Christ is going to make us free. No, he has made me free. I'm free from having to measure up to anything because of what Jesus has done. Now watch this. And do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. I talked about this 2 weeks ago. Do not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. It's not talking about sin. The yoke of bondage is the requirements of the law. Of law, period. Now we think, well, we're not Jewish, so we're not under the Mosaic law. But see, people put laws on themselves all the time. And as Naomi says so accurately, this is where legalism comes in. Man's attempts to control the darkness. Man's attempts to get people to live right. We want people to live right, but if I got to put rules on you to make you live right, it doesn't work. Amen. Thank you, Emerson. I told Emerson to Salem me because I'm excited. Hallelujah. So the many faces of self-righteousness, and the Lord gave me an acronym. Go to Luke chapter 18. Luke chapter number 18. This is so good. I wrote down some definitions of religion too as we're going to Luke 18 verse 9. Religion teaches you to do what Jesus has already done. Did you hear that? Religion teaches you to do what Jesus has already done. Amen. In other words, we're doing things to try to be something that he's already made us. You go back to the garden, the temptation. When the serpent tempted Eve, he says, if you'll partake of this tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you'll be like God. The truth is they were already like God. And he tried to get them to do something, to be something they already were. You know, I hear a lot of songs today, a lot of Christian songs, and there's a lot of good Christian songs, so please hear me. But a lot of them are, oh Lord, help me to be this and help this person to be that and be this and be that. And I'm thinking, what did Jesus do? Now, I understand position. This is where you got to understand. And then manifestation of that position. Are you hearing me? So I understand it that way. But that needs to be clarified. Because if you're born again, say, are you born again?
Born again.
You're in better shape than anybody's ever told you are. And we're going to continue to tell you because of what Christ has done. So it's not me trying to be anything. It's me understanding what he's already made me. That's why Paul prayed in Ephesians chapter 1 that the eyes of your understanding, literally the heart is the Greek word there, the eyes of your heart, the Amplified Bible says, would be flooded with light that you might know what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance, the exceeding riches of his kindness, his greatness toward us, etc., etc. The inheritance in the saints. The inheritance is in the saints, not outside the saints. See, we still pray, if you think about it. We're still praying, oh God, come down. Open the heavens. Rend the heavens out of Isaiah. Aren't we praying that? People have that attitude. The truth is, God's already in you if you're born again. Isn't that powerful? That's why you bow your head when you pray, right? So you can look at God. Some of us look like we got more of God than the others. It's not true, though, all right? Amen. So also, this is powerful. This is something that the Lord gave me an acronym. Say self.
Self.
S-E-L-F. Now watch this. And I'm going to read these verses here, and then I'm going to come back and talk about it. I'm going to go from about verse 9 through about verse 14. Jesus, also, he spake this parable to some who trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. There's a whole revelation there. Okay, but let's go down to about verse 14. So they trusted in themselves that they were righteous. Result, they despised others. Boy, I could, golly. You know, we have to be careful that we don't start thinking that because we got grace and the new covenant, that we don't somehow think we're better than others. Okay, let me give you something that's really powerful. God loves people. He really does. He loves them. And I'm not saying there's not people you got to separate from and stuff. But if we start thinking, bless God, our church has got a corner on God, that's elite, it's self-righteous, and it's arrogant. It's self-righteous. Did you hear that? Now watch this. The next verse. Two men went up to the... He's given a parable, an illustration, that two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a tax collector. The word Pharisee literally means separated one. Thought that was interesting. And the other a tax collector. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself. That's so amazing. It says he prayed. You know, the Bible says in Matthew chapter 6 that hypocrites love to pray. Amen? Now, godly people love to pray too. But you can pray and have wrong prayers. You can pray with yourself. What did you say about how some people, they pray in their prayers, they're actually talking to the person. You know, Lord, pray for so-and-so and this and that. And they're actually talking to the person more than they're communing with God in their prayers. Or some people go before God and they just go on and on about the problem. We need to go on and on about the answer. Amen? Amen. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank you that I am not like other men. Extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. Wow. This guy's spiritual, isn't he? Next verse. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I possess. Next verse. And the tax collector, standing afar off, would not so much as raise his eyes to heaven, but beat upon his breast, saying, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. Next verse. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified, the second man, the tax collector, rather than the other, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. Notice the exaltation is of self. He exalts himself. That's why I said when we take our interpretation of the Bible above the Bible, we're playing God. Well, that's what I think. You can have an opinion, but everything... See, I don't care about what I think. Did you hear what I said? I really don't. I want what's right. That's not just a facade of humility. I mean that. This life in this realm, the Bible calls it a vapor. Amen? James chapter 4, verse 14. What is your life? Is even a vapor. It appears for a little time and then vanishes away. We just talked about how July starts tomorrow. This year just started. I think we're moving pretty quick. Amen? We're over halfway through the year. So I don't want to spend my whole life doing my own thing and calling it God and stand before the Lord and say, you know what? You did your own thing. I love you, but you're in because of the blood. Amen. All right. This man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. The Bible says, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God, and he will exalt you in due time. How do you do that? You cast all your care, all your concern, all of self upon him. You quit making it about you and start making it about Jesus. Well, here's my acronym, all right? The S stands for separate. You read this entire parable here, this entire account, there's two separations. Number one, they separate from the Spirit. And the result of separating from the Spirit is we separate from our brethren. Now watch this. Are you ready? Go to the book of Jude and look at verse 19. One chapter, 25 verses, Jude verse 19. Watch this. Now, I'm going to say some things that if you get a hold of this, this is one of the most life-changing things on the planet. I got to say this to you. So many people are interpreting the Bible with their intellect rather than their spirit. The Bible's not written to your head. It's written to your heart. Now, it'll affect your head, but it's not written to your head. It's not something you can analyze your way into. You must operate by the Spirit of God. Amen. Now, he's talking about all these people in the body of Christ. In verse 4, he talks about how they turn the grace of God into lasciviousness or licentiousness, unbridled lust, etc., etc. And it says, but notice what they do. These are they who are sensual. And I looked up this word sensual, and it means they're led by their psuche, their soul. They're dominated by what they feel. They're animal-like, one of my interlinears says. They're animal-like. They operate by simply by their five senses. And notice what it says. Who caused divisions, not having the Spirit. Let me go to, could I have the King James on this? Because I like it better in the King James. Because it's really good. I want you to see it in the King James. Thank you. These be they who separate themselves. And I thought, what do they separate themselves from? The Spirit of God. The Spirit. The Bible says the natural man doesn't receive the things of the Spirit. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14. He doesn't receive the natural man. What's the natural man? It's the man that's led just by his senses. Now, thank God for our senses, but they're not to lead us. They're to be servants to our born-again spirit man. But it says they separate themselves. What did that Pharisee do in Luke chapter 4 or 18? He separated himself. He separated himself from God because even when he prayed to God, he started talking about himself. You see that? He didn't talk about, Lord, you know, he didn't come enter his gates with thanksgiving, into his courts with praise. It wasn't about the Lord. It was all about him. And see, and there's a great danger in the body of Christ, especially in Western cultures like our own, where we're so intellectual. And it has nothing to do with how high your IQ is. It has everything to do with trusting in your, leaning to your own understanding, trusting in your own heart, trusting in your own ideas. And the Lord says that's what a fool is. Proverbs 28, 26, the person that trusts in their own heart, according to the Word of God, God says that's what a fool is. I don't want to be that. How about you? But even as a believer, just because I'm born again, he wouldn't tell me to stand fast in the liberty and the freedom of the new covenant if there wasn't a temptation to not stand fast in the freedom of the new covenant. But he says these people that turn the grace of God into lasciviousness and license, they're sensual. They're sense-led. They're dominated by their five senses. In essence, they walk just like an animal. They're led just by their hormones and they're led. Woo, woo. That's why people are like, woo. That's why they're like that. But it's so important. Now they separate themselves from a walk of the Spirit. They're essential. And it says, having not the Spirit. And that perplexed me. And I thought, wow, that means they're not born again. That's not what that's saying. The word having not in Greek is in the present tense, which means it's continuous. And it's the Greek word echo. Say that, echo. E-C-H-O in English, and it means they do not hold to the Spirit of God. They do not, see it, if you don't hold to the Spirit of God, we separate ourselves from the brethren. That's a result of it. Amen? Amen. See, these be they who separate themselves, they're sense-led, they're not holding on to the Spirit of God. You mean I can do that as a believer? You sure can. I like to tell, if you're not going forward in your relationship with God, you are going backwards. Amen? It's just the way, and going forward is looking at Him, allowing the Spirit of God to work through you. I'm going to say it again. The Bible's not written to your head, it's written to your heart. It takes the Holy Spirit of God in a relationship with you, fellowship of the Holy Spirit, for you and I to understand the things of God. We cannot intellectualize our way in it. And I can promise you, offense comes when you just live in your soulish realm. Because sooner or later, somebody doesn't do you the way you think they should. And they're usually in the church. That's why the Bible says in Mark chapter 4, account of the parable of the sower. He talks about those people that receive the word of God gladly. They're happy. And the Bible says they endure for a while. When tribulation and persecution arises for the word's sake, immediately they're offended and they bring forth no fruit. It doesn't mean that if they're born again, it doesn't mean they're unborn again. It just means they're offended. How many people, I ain't going to church. I ain't dealing with that. Amen? Because they're offended. Let me say something else about this. People that separate themselves exalt knowledge. There's another danger in the body of Christ. There's a thing going on called intellectualism. You know what intellectualism is? Knowledge without adhering to the Spirit of God. And see, and the thing about intellectualism is you always got to have your next fix. Amen? You always got to get your next fix. So I got to have a deeper revelation. I know people that are getting what I call symbolically crazy. And it's all about, they're trying to go so deep and this means this and that means that and the hills means governments and blah, 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 blah. Now, there is symbolic stuff in the Scripture, but it's always found within the Scripture. And it's not something you pull out of your, I was going to say your hind end, but that don't sound good. Calm down. All right. They separate themselves, central, having not the Spirit. Next verse, you didn't think I was going to do it, did you? But ye beloved, look at that, beloved, but ye beloved. Now I'm going to give you a paraphrase. Stay connected to the Spirit. Stay connected to the Spirit. I went to a meeting yesterday over a couple hours away over in Indianapolis, and I love going with brothers. I love going with my wife. I love all that stuff because we talk the word, but I love going by myself. Cecil was over there, and I wanted to go over and see him in a morning session. Long story short, we had a big wedding in the afternoon, so I had to get back and try to play a joke on my wife. I pulled into the drive, was at our driveway when I was home, and I called her and said, man, this traffic just east of Indianapolis, I'm bottlenecked up here. And of course, she don't fall for it. She knows it. Whatever. I wanted her to freak out, I wanted her to go, I know, that's not nice, but well, it's funny though, right? Then she does it to me too, so, but we know each other, so we're on to each other. And so, anyhow, it was actually more funnier in my mind, as I was premeditating it. All right. And it says, but ye beloved. Now he's telling you to do something. Building yourselves up on your most holy faith. Now notice it doesn't say you build yourself up for your most holy faith. You build yourself up upon your most holy faith. You build yourself up upon your most holy faith. And how do you do that? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Do you know when you're praying in the Holy Ghost, and when I say that, I'm talking about private prayer and other tongues, you know what you're doing? The Lord spoke this to me yesterday. You're speaking forth the mind of Christ. Oh, we need to do this all the time. The Lord's told me this several times, and I had such a blast going over there yesterday. I'll tell you what, the Lord and I, we were having us a time. And the Lord just showed, I'm just seeing what it means to live out of my spirit and not out of my situations. And man, it's changed. I get so excited. I enjoy everything. Decent that is. I do, man. I never knew a cup of coffee could be so good. I never knew I loved the morning so much. I knew I loved the morning, but life is exciting because you're in the spirit. You're operating out of your spirit and not out of your soulish man. You're not looking to things to fulfill you. You've already got fulfillment, and now everything's just fun. Does that make any sense? See, people that believe the lie that, man, you get serious about God, there goes all your fun. There goes all of excitement. What a lie. What a lie. But we need a consistent lifestyle. Now here again, if you're born again, you're born again. Whether you ever pray in the Spirit or not, that's not the point. But if you don't pray in the Spirit, your spirit's never prayed. And we're going to come back here. I'm telling you, people don't realize how powerful this is. This is, I'm telling you, probably one of the greatest things the Lord has ever given us next to our born again experience is the baptism in the Holy Spirit and the prayer language to be able to speak forth the mind of Christ. Do you know there's tragedies in your future that the enemy wants you to go through? Do you know you can thwart those through the ministry of the Holy Ghost? Amen. 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 Well, Chris, why does bad things happen to good people? Well, we should say, why does good things happen to bad people? But that's just from a human perspective. Because technically every human's missed it in and of themselves. But I'm telling you, we live in a broken world. And if you ever see, there's fields that have landmines in them, This life has landmines in them. And sometimes when people are young, they think, well, I don't need that. I mean, trust me, there's coming a day. You're going to get older. All of a sudden, healing's going to mean a little bit more to you than it did back when you were 20. Amen? I'm telling you, it's true. It's true. But the Holy Ghost, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion, the koinonia, or the fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with you all, 2 Corinthians 13:14. His grace, because of His love, is made real through the communion or the fellowship of the Holy Ghost, and He communes and fellowships with your born-again spirit. Not with your head. See, that's the problem in the body of Christ. We're trying to have a relationship with God through our head instead of with the Spirit. But ye, beloved, building up yourselves up on your most holy faith. How? Praying in the Holy Ghost. Next verse. Watch this. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Keep yourselves in the love of God. I told you one translation says, stay in the boundaries where God's love can reach and bless you. Stay always within the boundaries where God's love can reach and bless you. Stay in those boundaries. It's in the Spirit. Keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. That's not talking about when you die. Eternal life is knowing Him, John 17:3. Now back to Luke chapter, 18. So these people separate themselves from a walk of the Spirit. That's the one thing. Let me show you two more on staying connected to the Spirit. I'm not saying just praying in the Spirit, but I'm saying if you knew how powerful it was. But see, here's the thing. People try stuff and they say, I tried that for a while. You hear what I'm saying? I've been trying it for years. And I'm starting to really see results in my own personal life. See, it starts with me. I used to think God wanted to fix everybody else so they wouldn't rub me the wrong way. Now I'm seeing God wants my heart to be adjusted so people's craziness doesn't rub me the wrong way. Hear the difference? Nobody can do anything to you and affect you on the inside without your consent and cooperation. It's impossible. It's impossible. It's what's going on in you and I. What is it in me that causes me to react when someone cuts me off in traffic? What is it? Amen? Boy, we got the ministry of the Holy Ghost. See, we need to stay connected, though. And our culture makes me want to vomit when I think of how it's not emphasized, even in the body of Christ, even among charismatic churches, even among churches that believe that. You can go in our local Christian bookstore, and you can't find one book on the prayer language of the Holy Ghost unless you special order it in. That's sickening. Sorry. It's sickening. You know why? Because religion hates the ministry of the Holy Ghost. Oh, we believe in the Holy Ghost, brother. Yeah, but you don't talk about being baptized in the Holy Ghost and using that heavenly language to get you out of your fat head and into your born-again spirit. Amen. I love to pray in the Holy Ghost and listen for God's voice. And His voice comes through impressions. We'll be talking about that sometime. How He'll impress upon me. And I like to say stuff like, Lord, as I'm praying, just direct me where you want me to go in the Scripture. I was doing that the other day, and all of a sudden it just came to me. Go to, I actually tell you, it was 1 Peter chapter 2. And so I just kept seeing 1 Peter chapter 2. It was impressed. I went there, got three verses in, and was blown away. Don't tell me God ain't talking. He'll guide you into the truth. It's not about God talking. It's about us listening. But we're trying to listen to God's voice up here instead of down here. Because people don't know the difference. But that's not going to be here. We're going to change that. But obviously it's up to you and I. All right. Keep yourselves in the love of God. Now, and another thing that, 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I'm going to show you just a couple verses out of here. We'll start with verse 2 quickly. These are amazing verses. Amazing. Amazing verse. You know, I know when people are baptized in the Holy Spirit and they will commune and fellowship with the Holy Spirit, they will always stay on fire. I'll use Pick on Rich as an example. I've known Rich for over 10 years. We've been good friends. But you know, one of the things that both of us have done consistently is we believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit and we operate in it. So even though neither of us have had our doctrines perfectly and we're growing and we're still doing that and didn't understand grace at one time, that fire and that desire for the things of God is strong. And it's stronger now that we see it's about what Jesus did and not about what we're doing, not even about our praying. Even our praying in the Holy Ghost doesn't cause God to do anything. Praying in the Holy Ghost helps you understand what Jesus has already done. That's why He says He guides you into all truth. He guides you. He is the truth. He's guiding you in it. John 16:13. It's a picture of a tour guide. You ever seen a tour guide? I like to pretend I'm one sometime until people figure out this guy's clueless. But you know, it means it's a picture of a tour guide and guiding you into unknown territory. Unknown by what? By your brain. The Holy Spirit will guide you into it. Let me show you just a couple verses. Wow, it's been a long time. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue, he's not talking to men. He's talking to God. What is he saying? The Bible says here, watch this, for no man understands him, howbeit in the Spirit, he's speaking mysteries. Did you catch that? Do you ever have things on your heart and you don't even know how to express it? The Holy Ghost will express it for you if you will let him. You know why intellectual people, I'm just talking about a lot of times intellectuals that lean to that, which we all have that temptation. You know why we struggle? Because when you're praying in the Holy Ghost, it's pure spirit. That's it. Your feelings are like, whoa, what's going on, man? Entertain me, juggle, do something. It's pure spirit. That's why I recommend getting to where you read the word and just praying in the Holy Ghost throughout your day when you're driving with your eyes open. Pray in the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost will quicken things to you. And all of a sudden, see, you know it's God because you know you're not that smart. I'm serious. I know that's funny, but he speaks things that are so profound. I know Rich, and he said something the other day that rocked my world, and I know him. It ain't him. Sorry, Rich. He can't take credit for it. It's the Holy Ghost. Oh, this is so powerful. I wish more people would talk about it and emphasize it. Paul did. Let me get look at verse 4. He speaks mysteries. Next, look at verse 4. He that speaks in an unknown tongue edifies himself, but he that prophesies or speaks forth to the church edifies the church. Now stop. The word prophecy means to speak forth the mind of God. But it says, he that speaks in an unknown tongue, he edifies himself. Literally, oikodomio in Greek, and it means to build upon, it means to raise an edifice, it means to promote spiritual growth. Wow. 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 It's like plugging in, it's like flipping a power switch. One man of God said, it's like taking a bucket and reaching down in your born-again spirit and pulling up the life of God. I want all that. I'm telling you, the fire's in the Holy Ghost. It's in his ministry. This is why people get excited. And once the newness wears off, whatever happened to so-and-so? Emotions in motion. It's an old Billy Squire song. That's called a flashback. It's what it is. It's emotions in motion. That's all it is. It's what it is. He that speaks in an unknown tongue, he edifies himself. He promotes spiritual growth, but he that prophesies edifies the church. Go down to verse 14, I think. No, verse 13. Thank you. Wherefore, let him that speaketh in an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret. Now, this is talking about in a public assembly, but it also applies individually. Individually. You can apply this individually. Throughout your day, say, Lord, as I'm praying in the Spirit, show me what I'm saying. Give me the interpretation. You sensitize yourself. You learn to hear the voice of God. And the voice of God can save your life. Amen. You know, God's speaking all the time. The question is, are we listening? There's radio waves in here all the time. Did you know that? All different radio stations and television stations are broadcasting. It's not a matter of them transmitting. It's a matter of us receiving. Do we have a receiver? If you're born again, you do. But is that receiver tuned in to the voice of God? Yes or no? And just understanding that God speaks in that still small voice, those impressions. How many of you have ever done something and after you've done it and it didn't turn out good, you said, I knew I shouldn't have did that. Amen. We've all done that. Amen. I tell people the only thing worse than learning from experience is not learning from experience. I have a feeling that God's way is a lot better than our way. Oh, to spurn anything that God has for us. And this is so vital. We got to get out of our head and into his mind. Okay, I got to hurry. Next verse. This is so amazing. For if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit prays. The part of you that's born again prays. But if I don't ever do that, my spirit never prays. You know, most of the time when we pray psycho prayers. What are psycho prayers? I can't tell you how many people I've loosed to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. Well, it's in the Bible. Yeah, but that's an extreme case, and you don't do that unless you are absolutely led of the Holy Ghost. This isn't witchcraft. Amen. Hallelujah. For if I pray, my spirit prays, but my understanding is fruitful. Next verse. And I got to hurry to the next point. What is it then? What is the conclusion? I will pray with the spirit and I will pray with the understanding. I will do what? I will. This is the Apostle Paul, who in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, just a few chapters before, said, follow me as I follow Christ. Follow me as I follow Christ. Why do we make that so hard? Why do we make that so hard? I'll tell you what, if you have an everyday time of communion with the Holy Ghost, and you will stay in the fire of God. But I'm telling you, your feelings are going to rebel, especially if you've been so used to being led of your senses and your feelings and feelings. You know, they're going to rebel. This isn't fun. I thought they said, all I'm getting is a dry mouth and a heavy tongue and a tired jaw. This isn't fun at all. I don't like this. But if you stay in there and you just, throughout your day, that's the beauty of it. You don't have to go anywhere to get in touch with God. He's with you wherever you go. When you go check your beehives, you can pray in the Holy Ghost. Thinking, I don't have any beehives, so that's all right. What is it then? I will pray with the Spirit. I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also. Powerful. Stay connected to the Spirit of God. Amen? Now, the second thing that people do, if they're not connected to the Spirit of God, then they separate from people. Let me give you a manifestation of pride. I know people that think they're God's man or woman, and they're prophets, and they're all these kind of things, but some things they say are so unscriptural, it ain't even funny. You know how many people are led by words instead of the word? Let me show you this scripture. Go to 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20. I got to hurry. I will. 4 minutes and 44 seconds. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20. Knowing this first. Now, if you read this context, he talks about a booming voice from heaven that said, this is my beloved son. And he says in the previous verse, I believe it is, we have a more sure word of prophecy than even an audible voice from heaven. Now, that's awesome. And the next verse he's talking about, it's the scripture. Say it's the scripture. It's the word of God. It's a more sure word of prophecy. That's awesome. You know how many cults have started by people that said they heard a voice from heaven? One guy said he heard a voice from heaven, said everybody was wrong. First clue. First clue. Anything that comes to you, say, bless God, we are the elite. We are all that. No, you're not. There's one great name. And it's not Chris, it's Christ. Real funny thing, I got to tell you this. I drive some busing for Peterman in the summer. And this one lady sent an email to or something, called one of the people there about having me drive that same route. So that was a compliment. They liked me. And so they sent to Greg, my boss, they said, and it was a typo. Greg was laughing so hard. He said, could you please have Christ drive that bus? or that van. And Greg typed back and he goes, I don't have Christ, but I'll send his messenger. That's awesome. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation. I used to, and this does apply. I always thought, well, Emerson can't say it means this, and Dan says it means this, and then I say it means this, and so. Yes, that applies, but what he's talking about is scripture has to be interpreted by scripture. Amen? You don't pull out isolated passages and ignore other passages. And when anybody esteems their words above the word of God, even though they usually have one scripture and there's not two or three to back it up, look out. You remember the story in 1 Kings chapter 13 about the prophet? And God gave him a word and he was to declare judgment and all these types of things, and he was not to stop anywhere. He was just to do his thing and leave. And then another guy came out and said he was a prophet too, and that God told him that you're supposed to come back to my house. You can read it in 1 Kings 13. And when he did, then that prophet who brought him back to his house said, you should have listened to the voice of the Lord. Mm. Are you hearing me? And he ended up losing his life. Because even though someone can sound spiritual, if they're not backed up by Scripture, let me show you this one. First Corinthians chapter 14, and I think it's verse 29. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 29. Let the prophet speak two or three, watch this, and let the other what? Judge or discern. Anytime anybody gives you anything, if they get upset that you judge it according to the Word of God, run like a scalded dog. And I've heard people, God told me you're going to marry so-and-so, you're going to do this. Total disasters. What is the remedy for that? We need the Word. We need to grow in grace. We need to have relationship with the Holy Spirit. We need not separate ourselves from Him. Amen? Now, separate. These people separate themselves from God. I got to hurry. All right? They separate themselves from a walk of the Spirit, a walk in relationship, which causes them to separate themselves from their brethren. Listen, I'm going to give you a form of self-righteousness that's, people that don't have a church and live in this area are arrogant, self-righteous, deceived people. If there's no Grace Church around, then start one. Boy, it's quiet in this charismaniac church. It's the truth. But I know people that, you can't judge. I'm a woman of God. I'm a man of God. I'm this, I'm that. Listen, how my relationship is with God will manifest in my relationship with people. 1 John, I won't go there. Chapter 1, verse 7 says, if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. And the blood of Jesus Christ is having its cleansing effect on all of our life. Amen. But see, people separate themselves. Because, man, nobody's got the level of truth that they have. God's called you and I to work with imperfect people. Amen. I love to pick on my wife and I'll hear a good teaching or something say, man, honey, you really need this. It's all a joke. We have fun saying that. I'm giving you guys ideas. So let the prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. Now, I want to quickly go through this. So they separate themselves from a walk of the Spirit. That's the S. Which causes them to separate from their brethren. Amen? The E stands for exalt. They exalt themselves. Once again, they play God. Whenever I exalt my idea of truth above God's Word, I'm playing God. But most of the time, we let denominations and groups tell us what truth is. Even that's a form of playing God, because I'm letting somebody else tell me what truth is. I tell you all the time, don't take things because I say it. You go search it out. Be a Berean. Search the Scriptures, not weekly, not monthly, but daily, to see if those things are so. Get the CD. We can't make them any cheaper than free, and we're not paying you for taking them. All right? But you can do that, and you can meditate, and you can go, and God will give you more. So they separate themselves from the Spirit, which causes them to separate themselves from the brethren. They exalt themselves, which is obvious. And the L stands for laud, L-A-U-D, which means they praise themselves. You read the story in Luke chapter 18, the man started talking about all of his accomplishments, tithing and fasting. Nothing wrong with those things in their right context. See, God's more interested in what you do than why you do what you do than what you actually do. You need to remember that. God's interested in the heart behind what you do. Amen. And seeing that taproot of self-righteousness runs deep. This is why people struggle with healing. We all, because we're focused on us. See, grace makes it about Jesus. Law makes it about me. They separate themselves. They exalt themselves. They laud or praise themselves. The word laud literally means praise. Their accomplishments and their is whacked, because instead of focusing on what Christ has done, they focus not only on themselves, but they focus on the shortcomings of others. You know, I can feel good about me when I start putting other people down below me. And then that makes me see people that are always putting other people down are very insecure people, because they're trying to bring people down so they can lift themselves up. And so when you start seeing that pain, I heard a story one time about this cat, and these people had this cat and one day they called it Mother Cat, and the cat was a real sweet cat all the time, until one day the guy walks out and he says the cat went rear, was just not itself. In other words, it snipped. Well, they found out that Mother Cat had been hit by a car. And so normally the cat was very gentle, but because of the hurt, the cat was lashing out. They took the cat to the vet, fixed it up, and everything was fine. Here's the point. People that lash out, people that belittle other people, are very hurt, insecure people. And when you start seeing them that way, it helps you to be able to deal with them. Instead of lashing back, see, you don't let other people's issues become your issues. And that's the problem. So many times people have issues. There's issues in all of us. But they let those issues become their issues. In other words, they're letting what they do on the outside get on the inside of them. You ever heard the saying, like, people play basketball or football or whatever, and they're trying to get inside someone's head? They say stuff and trash talk, and they're trying to get inside their opponent's head. You know what I'm talking about? That's exactly what this stuff does. But if you're adhering to Christ, and you have that relationship with the Lord in the person of the Holy Ghost, and you're not exalting self, you're abasing self. Amen? In the sense that it's not about you, it's about Him. You're the beneficiary. Are you hearing that? See, because the Bible says, once we start comparing ourselves among... Let me show you that, and we'll wrap it up here. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. 2 Corinthians. Now I, Paul, myself, beseech you... That's one, but can I have verse 12? That's good too, though. Thank you. For we dare not make ourselves of the number... and compare ourselves with some that commend themselves. Wow, wow, wow. That's what he's talking about. When we make ourselves of the number, we fall into the same trap that the world lives in. What is that trap? We begin to compare ourselves with some that commend themselves. We start comparing ourselves. See, the standard is Christ. Amen? See, people can have it seemingly going on the outside and be miserable on the inside. The old saying, most people live lives of quiet desperation. A lot of Christians live that way because they don't understand what Christ has done. All right? For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves, they are not wise. See, now, what is the antidote to all of this? I have to give you another acronym sometime. GROW. GROW in what? GROW in the grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. GROW. Grow. Somebody say, oh, bless God, brother. I've been a Christian for 21 years, when in reality, they've just lived 1 year 21 times. Hear the difference? Hear the difference? We should be increasing in our understanding. And you could tell that by our levels of excitement in Christ. Amen? There's so much joy. The Bible says, as we behold in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8, we rejoice with joy unspeakable, inexpressible, and full of glory. And if you read that in context in 1 Peter chapter 1, he was talking to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia, all this persecution that was going on. And he said, listen, as you behold Christ, you rejoice with joy inexpressible, unspeakable, full of glory. Because joy is an inward thing, not an outward thing. Happiness is based on happenings. And I can assure you that if you're experiencing joy on the inside, a whole lot's happening on the inside, and that's a happening that's consistent. It's called joy. Amen. Glory to God. I guess I'm going to have to stop. Hallelujah. Are you blessed? Amen. I'll tell you, sometimes I got to share this with you, but I'm really going to always encourage you to pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Because I find a lot of people aren't, there are a couple on TV that are really saying it. But sometimes I think people, I mean, if you say it to me every day, pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray much in the Holy Ghost. Although the Holy Ghost always says it to me anymore. But because it's the difference. It's the difference between, the Bible says, if we live in the Spirit, Galatians chapter 5, verse 25, let us also walk in the Spirit. And I think, well, what does that mean? See, I want to know what these things mean. Don't throw this biblical terminology at me and not give me some type of definition. But when you pray in the Holy Ghost, the Bible says your spirit's praying. Your understanding's got to go over there and take a seat. See, your understanding, this thing up here, is like the little spoiled child. Sit over there and shut up. Serious. The intellect. People got to know everything. I heard Joseph Prince say something one time, how he said, people will say, I must know, I must know, I must know. Who are you? Are you Chinese? Are you Indian? Are you Hawking? I must know. And I never forgot that. That's powerful because that's what it is. This intellect thinks it's all that, and it's not. We need to put on humbleness of mind, Colossians 3:12. Humbleness of mind. We need to exalt the word above. But see, you can't. None of these things you can do with willpower. It takes the Holy Ghost. What is religion? It's man serving God in his own strength. Did you catch that? Man's religion is man serving God in his own strength, with his own ideas, with his own reason, all that stuff. And so that's why we come up. They, being ignorant of God's righteousness, which is a free gift, they go about to establish their own righteousness. They have not submitted themselves unto the free gift of the righteousness of God, which is in Christ. For Christ is the end of the law to those who believe. He's the end of the law of having to measure up. See, that's the freedom. You've already measured up. Are you going to let him teach you? See, the Holy Ghost is a teacher, but you got to show up for class. Well, he teaches me. See, that's this universal mindset that's permeating the body of Christ today, trying to counterfeit the grace of God, which says that, yeah, you're under grace, so basically, you don't do nothing because it's all God. He just does it all. That's a lie. It's turning the grace of God into license, lasciviousness, licentiousness, absence of restraint. We're not under a Mosaic law. We're not under this law, that law, but we are under a law. It's called the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus that has made me free from the law of sin and death that exists out here in the world. You don't think sin and death exist? Look around. Flip the news on. Drive around. Look around. We've seen recently, my wife and I, we were talking about a lot of the young kids today. Is it just me? But do some of these young kids look really hard? Do they look hard and like they look hard? Like they're like they've been hurt, and that you can just tell, and they're hard. Whew. Law of sin and death. But if people can just see Jesus and not religion, if you can just hear, that's what I pray. I pray today. I pray, Lord, yes, I want to speak the oracles of God, but let people hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the churches. Which I want to get into that too. Because there's a promise to all seven churches and applies to us. And every one of those promises is to him that overcomes. And the Greek word overcoming, it means it's in the present tense, which means he's overcoming. But I thought we have overcome. Yes, we have through Christ. But what is overcoming? It's our faith in Christ. That's what overcomes the world, 1 John 5:4. And when you see every one of these promises that are available, if I keep my faith in what Jesus did, that's the fight. See, because that's why it says, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, Colossians 2:6. How did you receive him? Question. Was it because you were so great? Did you have to get cleaned up to take a bath? No, you take a bath to get cleaned up, right? I know that's deep. No, I'm just kidding. No, but the same way you received him, it says walk that way. And when you get that root in you, that's what will never change. Rooted and built up in him and established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. If you're established in the faith, you abound with thanksgiving. Beware lest any man, not any devil, but any man spoil you, take you captive through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Be careful that no man puts you under rules of touch not, taste not, handle not, which are all to perish with the using, after the commandments of the doctrines of men, which have a show of wisdom and will worship and humility, but they have no power against the indulgence of the flesh. None of these rules we put on people will change everything, because they're just something external that cannot do anything internal. But if you realize what you have internally through Christ and operate by the Holy Spirit of God, guess where the power flows? Paul said in Romans 1:9, I thank my God whom I serve with my spirit. That's where the Holy Ghost resides. That's where the power plant's at. It's in you if you're born again. You're not a slave to sin. You're free in Jesus' name. Praise God, it's earlier than it's ever been. Are you blessed?
Amen.
Amen. Now, wait a minute. Stop. Before you go, I want to say, we want to make three things available to you. Number one, born again. It's the greatest miracle of all. You must be born again. You can't even see the kingdom of God. That's what it says, John chapter 3, verse 3. You can't see it. You hear about it, but you can't see it. Amen. So we're going to make that available to you. The next thing is the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Do you know why people struggle with receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost? Right here. We overanalyze things. It doesn't come from here. So that's why I am so thankful growing up that I never had any teaching on it, because it was just so easy for me to receive, because it was just, that was one area where ignorance was bliss. It just flew out of me. And I'm very thankful for that. But I want to make that available to you. And the next thing I want to make available to you, if anybody needs prayer for any type of healing, we want to release the life of Christ. And we're going to believe God for that. We've heard some amazing things. I got some great stuff I want to get into on healing that's really good. I mean, really good. And so we want to make that available to you. But now here's what I want you to know. Hopefully everybody's born again. Hopefully everybody's baptized in the Holy Ghost. And hopefully there's none sick among you. I've been standing on Psalm 105, verse 37, where the children of Israel, when they came out of Egypt, are you ready for this? It says there was not one feeble one among their tribes. That's what I'm standing on. So trust me, my desire is that there's not one feeble one. There's not any sickness among any of us. That's a good thing. Amen? And I want to encourage you throughout your week, ask the Lord. Take opportunities. If someone says they're dealing with something, just ask them, can I pray for you? And take that authority and release it. Somebody said, what if it doesn't work? What if it does? I guarantee if you don't do nothing, it ain't going to work. Guaranteed. Write it down. And it didn't work. Did you pray? No. No, well, no wonder. It can't work if you don't release any power. Amen? So anybody, before you go, anybody want to be born again? Well, everyone's looking around. All eyes are on you. Anybody? I'm teasing. Anybody? Okay? Because I want to go out and hug necks if no one's going to come up here. Does anybody want to be baptized in the Holy Ghost? The desires to. Nobody? Anybody want prayer for any type of ailment? Not your husband or wife. Anybody? Are everybody good? Are you blessed? Okay, we got another thing I want to talk. I've got so many good things on the power of your words too. But a lot of people try to say words when it's not a revelation in their heart. Amen? See, when it's a revelation in your heart, we, having the same spirit of faith, we believe, therefore we speak. So I like what Cecil said. It's at least 2 hours in China. It's hard to stop. It's so good. So good. But so we're going to speak some words of faith right now, all right? These are words of faith. There's an environment of faith here. Say, I'm blessed.
I'm blessed.
I'm favored.
I'm favored.
I'm in Christ.
I'm in Christ.
I'm anointed.
Anointed.
I'm gifted.
I'm gifted.
I'm called. The very life of Christ,
is in me.
I'm a walking, talking temple of the Holy Ghost. Everywhere I go, I'm blessed. You lead me to right relationships. You protect me from wrong. I know your voice. The Word of God says, the sheep hear His voice. I'm a sheep. I don't feel any horns. You're a sheep. Amen? Amen? You're blessed. Amen. Have an awesome week. Give the Lord a hand.